How many of you remember watching that movie for the first time? Oh God, you're all old.1982, Steven Spielberg's incredible movie, E.T. It even surpassed Star Wars in sales and in attendance. It was the blockbuster movie of the 1980s. And if you remember the story, Spielberg actually developed the character of E.T. On the basis of an imaginary friend that he had created in his own mind when his parents had divorced earlier in the 1960s. So he based the movie and the plot around that. So, of course, for those of you who are born after that age and didn't see it, this is, of course, E.T., one of the most famous movies of all time, space movies. And the story, of course, is about Elliot, who's a lonely little boy who befriends a stranded extraterrestrial who ends up on Earth, who is dubbed E.T., and Elliot and his siblings go to great lengths to protect E.T. both from their mother and from the U.S. government, and to help E.T. find his way back home. And if any of you kids, or we got a few of you here, if you haven't seen it, it's on Netflix right now. Get the popcorn out. Put your feet up on a Friday night and watch it. It's one of the greatest movies of all time. So, I want to talk about extraterrestrials this morning. Is that okay? And why? Well, just like, it's fun. And I thought I'd go way out there with you this morning, no pun intended. So, talk about extraterrestrials, but also because one of the biggest stories in scientific cosmology to emerge recently has been the discovery of 7 potentially habitable planets just next door to us in terms of the cosmos, just 39 light years away, just basically a hop and a skip across the universe in terms of the infinity of the universe, just a hop and skip in the constellation of Aquarius. So what scientists have discovered in this constellation of Aquarius, they've discovered a dim dwarf star named TRAPPIST-1. And there are these 7 planets rotating around this dwarf star. And with the energy of the star and the proximity of the planets to the star, they have surmised that there's a strong likelihood that water and potentially atmosphere, and as a result of that, potentially life exists on these 7 planets in this area. And so there's this distinct possibility that extraterrestrials may actually exist. Scientists actually, as a result of these discoveries, and if you've been watching cosmology lately, and they're starting to speculate that there might be thousands, gazillions of planets, out, given the size of the universe, where there is habitable life, right? It's all over. So scientists today are saying it's no longer a matter of if we meet up with extraterrestrials someday. It's simply a matter of when. It's likely, all likelihood, it's going to happen. So I don't know, I've paid a little bit of attention over the decades of my life to SETI research. SETI is the search for extraterrestrial intelligence, and these are huge programs all around the world, and most of the major democracies of the world have had scientific government programs pouring millions, even billions of dollars into SETI research, okay? And huge telescopes scanning the universe. Carl Sagan's movie Contact was one of the great movies that sort of revealed that kind of research. So if you're interested in that, you can go online, and you can even hook up your computer and get involved in SETI research, because SETI research invites people to sort of link up their personal computers to their research methodologies to add computing power. So it's all very, very, very interesting. But SETI research has gone up and down with government budgets over the decades. But right now it's kind of in a hot zone once again. So they really think that extraterrestrials do exist. And you know what? They may have even, according to some people, they may have already visited Earth, right? And you know that there are probably secret CIA or government labs that have extraterrestrial remains in them, at least according to conspiracy theorists, right? So anyways, so I find all this stuff fascinating. And this recent discovery has been very interesting. So I got to thinking about myself a little bit. I got thinking about, so now, if science is suggesting, yes, indeed, extraterrestrials do exist, there is life that exists on the universe. It may look like ET, it may be cuddly little, ugly, but cuddly little forms of life, or maybe something else entirely. What are the theological and spiritual implications of this life existing in the universe? That's an interesting kind of tack to take every now and again, right? So I got thinking about this, and then I got thinking, it must drive exclusivist thinkers literally around the bend. It must drive their, you know, their, it's sort of like, they must drive them to the snapping point of insanity to think about the possibilities of extraterrestrials coming and visiting the Earth. Just think about an ISIS fighter, okay? Think about an ISIS fighter in Syria or somewhere in the Middle East. And the ISIS fighter is confronted by an extraterrestrial. Now, I know I'm stretching a little bit, so just bear with me a little. This is, I told you this is going to be a little wacky this morning, right? So just think about an ISIS fighter having to meet up with an extraterrestrial. Now, he or she has to think about, now, is this extraterrestrial an American or European? No, obviously not. If they look like ET, they're not going to be American or European, right? So can I co-opt this extraterrestrial to work with me in my cause? Might they join me in my cause? No, that's, could I convert them to my kind of politics? No, that would be highly problematic, I would think. So think about this one. Think about the Southern Baptist pastor who's absolutely committed to the belief that in order to get to heaven, you need to be a convert to Christianity and to Jesus in order to get to heaven. You need to accept Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. Or you might be an Islamic imam who thinks that you need to be converted to Islam in order to get to heaven, right? Through their, you know, with the, anyways, I won't go there. What they think about it. But anyways, just think about it. Like, the whole universe becomes your mission field. It's no longer just the Earth. It's no longer just other countries. You have to go out and you have to convert all the various extraterrestrials all around the cosmos to your belief system if any of them are going to have a chance to get to heaven. You've seen Star Wars. There might be billions of different kinds of extraterrestrials. How is that going to work? Or think about if you're a Republican right at this point in time. You knew I was going to go there sooner or later. I'm sorry for you Republicans who might be in the congregation at the moment. I mean, I love you dearly, but you have to consider this possibility. You want to build a wall to keep the Mexicans out. Well, for goodness sakes, how do you build a wall to keep the extraterrestrials out? Do you have to, that would be an engineering feat, right? I mean, what are you going to do to keep those guys out? It's, you can see that this is a situation that is very problematic. It's fraught with difficulties, right? A couple of key challenges in all of this. Now, if extraterrestrials get to us before we get to them, now think about the implications of that. Now, I told you that the Aquarius constellation is just a hop and a skip. It's 39 light years from planet Earth, right? But that little hop and a skip is totally beyond the technological or intellectual expertise of human science at this point in time. So if any extraterrestrials get to us first, it means that they will have surmounted the humongous kinds of intellectual and scientific and technological advances required to engage in interspace travel, okay? It's a huge, science has gone to huge places these days, but in terms of interstellar travel, it's just totally beyond our capacity at this point. So if the extraterrestrials get here first, you can bet that their technology and their science and their intellectual advancements will be far beyond anything that we human beings have possibly achieved to date. It would not be a good idea to try and force our politics or our thinking down their throats, because believe me, I think we'll be in trouble if we try any of that with extraterrestrials. Now, think about this too. If extraterrestrials from this advanced kind of civilization get to us first, right? Our political thinking and systems, as well as our probably religious and spiritual sort of paradigms and ways of thinking, will also likely be far inferior. They won't even come close to matching the superiority of their political and religious kinds of views on the universe of their organization. Oh my goodness, that will be a come down for any political or religious kinds of people who think, I've got the only way, and my way but the highway is the only way that works in the universe. Can they handle that kind of blow to the human ego? I mean, that would be phenomenal, don't you think? The modern Jews may not have it right, but the ancient Jews did. The ancient Israelites had been speculating, I'm sure, about extraterrestrials back in their day and age, and they had come up with the solution to how we deal with extraterrestrials back in their day and age. And this is what they suggested. And this is why, now listen again to what Eloise shared with you earlier, right? From Deuteronomy, you shall also love the stranger, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt. And then this is where I know that they had been visited by extraterrestrials and knew about it, because the Bible, this is the way it reads. The alien who resides with you shall be to you as the citizen among you. See, they had aliens back then. The alien who resides with you shall be to you as the citizen among you. You shall love the alien as yourself, for you were aliens in the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God. God tells us to love the aliens. Yeah. And Jesus says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor and your alien as yourself. Oh, he didn't use the word alien, but he said, and your neighbor as yourself. The ancient Israelites had experienced many times, not just in Egypt, but throughout their history, experienced times of exile, of being deported to foreign lands where they were the strangers, where they were the underdogs, where they were dependent upon the hospitality and the generosity and the care and compassion of people who had no other real connection with them. And so in the midst of that experience, they developed the wisdom over time to suggest that, you know what? It's actually just, from our own experience, it's kind of the nice, good, human thing to do is to be nice to strangers, is to treat strangers and to treat foreigners, to treat people who aren't from here with some care and some compassion and some respect and to look out for them. And they also, so that was kind of the one thing, you know, it's just what you do as human beings. You look out for one another because you're all humans or aliens or creatures of life. You know, you look out for the strangers and the foreigners. You take care of them. And the other thing, they were also, you know, it's like Newfoundlanders. How many of you are Newfoundlanders here, right? They were They're also very, very astute. And what I've noticed with Newfoundlanders, they're very warm and caring people, but they also know how to work the angles all the time. They're always very astute about this. And the ancient Israelites, I know Newfoundlanders are the best business people in the world, right? So the ancient Israelites also figured out when you're dealing with a stranger or you're dealing with a foreigner, you're never 100% sure who or what it is that you're dealing with. And so it's always wiser to err on the side of, let's be nice to each other, rather than to err on the side of being super aggressive with each other, because you recognize they may hold the card someday, and it's just smart to develop a nice relationship with strangers, because they might be a benefit to you someday, right? You got it? And then there's a third insight that comes that they developed, and it's the insight of Jesus. And Jesus takes his whole insight to another spiritual level, and Jesus says, love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Because from God's perspective, you and your neighbor are as one. God loves everyone equally and totally and completely. And in fact, he pushes that when what you do for one of these, you do for me. He points to the kind of the mystical oneness of all of creation, that all people are actually part of God, derive life from God, participate in God's life. Therefore, all people are worthy of love and respect. Now, extrapolate a little bit further. Aliens are no different from humans in that regard. Extraterrestrials also will get their life from God. God is, by definition, the ultimate infinite power that gives life to absolutely everything. And we often think it's just us humans who have this special relationship to God, but if ETs exist out in the universe, they have their relationship with God too, and God gives them life too. So God will obviously love them and have an appreciation for them as well. So, you know, it just makes good sense. It just strikes me that this whole conception of extraterrestrials coming to Earth, like in the movie E.T., suggests to us, for all sorts of reasons, that we should be nice to one another, we should respect and care for one another, and we should see each other all as expressions of the one life of God and treat each other that way. And, you know, it's a funny thing. The kids in E.T., and it was the kids. It was the kids who got it, right? It was the kids who got it. It wasn't the adults who got it. Disney is brilliant. Spielberg's brilliant, right? It's the kids who got it. And that's what Jesus said. Jesus said, if you want me to show you what the realm of God is like, bring a child to me. And it's the relationship with children that will show you the realm of God, the kingdom of God, Jesus says. So, here's what I think. I've got the solution to all these global problems that are facing the world at the moment. I do. You know that about me. I'm really smart, right? I've got it. I got the solution. I know exactly what to do. We want to take all these crazy politicians in the world today who don't get it, and all these fanatical religionists who don't get it, whatever spectrum of religion they come from, everybody who thinks there's outsiders and insiders and we got to protect our own and just our own national interests, we got to take all these crazy people around the world, we got to stick them into a room and make them watch the movie E.T. together. And I figure if they all see the movie E.T. together, you put them all in a room together, they're going to start to get an inkling of how to make this world a slightly more loving and caring place. And not just the world, the entire cosmos for that matter. Namaste, B.U.C.
Thank you.
Please be seated. And so the other reason I was doing this particular talk this morning is because we're welcoming a number of new people into fellowship in our community this morning. And you never know if there might be an extraterrestrial amongst them, just hidden. I'm not entirely sure about that, but that's why we proclaim ourselves to be a totally open and welcoming and inclusive community, because we think it's the way God calls us to be, and it's probably the safest way to be in this universe as well, because you just never know, right? So we're delighted to welcome new folk into membership. Some of these folks are transferring from other churches, and some of you are joining our community by profession of faith. When we invite you forward, we're just going to invite you all to respond to a few questions together collectively, but it's a time when we're delighted to welcome new folks into our community. So, Daryl, you're going to name these folks and invite them to come forward at this time.
Good morning. I was thinking of going to the 10 Great Day Retreat in August or September, but I think I might be rethinking that now. If there are any new members left, always engaging. I'm going to read the new members list. Some may have escaped, some may not be here this morning, and some may be at the 11 o'clock service. So if you are with us today, please come forward as I call your name. Linda Adamson, Mary Affleck, Leanne Boulay, Susan Kalpin, Deanna Clark, Art Forward, Deb Henley, Tony James, Chester King, Heather Christensen, Sandra McClellan, Sharon Olford, Cheryl Pierce, Don Poole, Lorraine Poole, Jerry Power, Mary Ellen Power, Judith Seward, Rob Smith, Joan Tompkins, and Greta Wilson.
So folks, some of you are becoming members by profession of faith, and some of you are simply transferring your membership from other communities. But I'm going to invite you all to respond to these three questions collectively and together, okay? Do you understand Jesus? To be a human window to God, one revealing to humankind the true nature and presence of God? If so, please say, I do.
I do.
Yeah. Following Jesus' example, will you open your lives to God's Spirit, inviting it to make you co-creators of life and community with God on earth? If so, please say, I will.
I will.
And do you commit yourself to support the Church of Jesus Christ and its ministry? If so, please say, I will.
I will.
Thank you. Diane.
Can I get you to make a bit of a circle? Yeah. And Daryl, why don't you come down with us? And Jen. And as I offer a blessing on our new members of Bedford United Church, I invite you in a prayerful way to send your intentions to them as we bless them. So, let us. You can put your hands down. We're going to bless you.
Why don't we all raise our hands?
Wondrous God, we give thanks for the many ways these, your children, have blessed our world. We give thanks that in this moment of their lives, they have chosen to share their faith and their ministries with the Bedford United Church congregation. We pray for your blessings on the unfoldings of their lives, their faith journeys, and their ministries, as they continue to add more beauty to your world. May it be so. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Well, now we're going to pin some boutonnieres on you here, so I think we'll, and as we do so, Daryl.
So on behalf of the BUC Council and the congregation, we want to welcome you to the BUC family. I had the privilege of spending the welcoming night with the new members a few weeks ago with David and Carolyn. And it was really nice because we had to keep getting extra chairs and extra chairs. We actually stuffed the parlor. So it's so nice to see so many new members joining us and the church. It was such a vibrant group that was open and questioning and really makes a great part of our congregation. And we thank you for choosing us as your church home and welcome you to Bedford United Church officially.
Thank you. Let's give a big hand.
Congratulations. Welcome. Are you a hugger? Are you a hugger?
No.
Welcome. Are you a hugger?
Friends, this is also the first Sunday of Lent. And Lent is a season in which we seek to draw closer to God and to one another. And what better way is there to do that than to share our communal meal? When Jesus sat at table and he broke bread with tax collectors, lawyers, rich elites, and poor peasants, he proclaimed that God's gracious love is absolutely for everyone.
Through these occasions of sharing food, children, women, and men experience God and shared in God's kingdom, a kingdom where all are welcome, all are worthy, and all are invited. Lives are transformed and empowered, and the fruits of God's gentle bloom throughout all of creation. All people, including each one of us, are invited to share in this sacred meal of celebration and to be strengthened by the presence of God in this place. Not one person, regardless of anything at all, is excluded from Christ's table.
Just let us take a moment to bow our heads in prayer. Divine source in whom we live and move and have our being, in the wilderness wanderings of our daily living, in joy and in struggle, you are a constant source of support and hope. When we wander through valleys of grief or uncertainty, you remind us through the words of Scripture, those of a friend, or from the still small voice from deep within, that we are not and never are alone.
As we gather to share the sacrament of communion, Holy One, we remember that Jesus came into the world to reveal how much you love us. He came as one of us, first an infant, then a child, a youth, and an adult. He rejoiced with those who rejoiced, and he wept with those who wept. To the despairing, he spoke a word of hope. To the sick, he gave healing. To the outcast and stranger, he was a friend.
In this season of Lent, O God, you call us closer to you, to one another, and to the world in need. You call us to compassion and service in the way of Jesus. So with open hearts and minds, we think of all those who struggle on this day. We hold in our hearts all who are ill or grieving, all who've experienced the loss of a relationship or a job, all around the world who live in fear and violence and oppression, all whom the world counts as last and least. For your precious creation in the fragile web of life, we hold all these in our hearts and pray that our intentions this day may result in action that conveys your love and grace. In the name of our brother Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Shortly before Jesus died, he gathered around him his closest friends, women and men who had shared his struggles and his triumphs. They met in a small upstairs room. The forces of power and self-interest were closing in upon them. In anticipation of his own impending death, Jesus took bread and the cup and likened it to his own life, broken and poured out for others.
In doing so, he invited them, and he invites all of us, to share in the brokenness of the world and to share too in the healing of the world through self-giving love. In bread broken and wine poured out, he initiated a new community, an inclusive community, an upside-down, upside-right community, which believes that loving is more important than winning, doing is more important, doing right is more important than doing what is safe, and setting people free more important than trying to control their lives. It's a community marked by justice and by hope.
Today, as we eat this bread and drink from the cup, we, like Jesus and his friends, are committing ourselves to serving our world with God's love and with God's justice.
We invite you, O God, to consecrate this meal and through it to continue to transform our hearts and minds with your Spirit. May this gift strengthen and nourish us to care and serve as Jesus himself did. My friends, this is bread of life. May we eat it. May we be glad for it. May we utilize it to nourish not just ourselves, but the entire world. Amen.
The cup of blessing for all of God's creations, wherever they may be. Amen.
Let us pray. Wonderful God, we give you thanks and praise that in your community, at your banquet of life, there are no outsiders. We are all insiders. We are all expressions of your life. We are all loved and cared for by you. May this meal reinforce our intention, the intention of Jesus, to create a world in which love bonds everyone together, in which love bonds the entire universe together, in a single fabric of love and unity and peace. In the name of our brother Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Please rise as you're able as we sing our closing song, Deep in Our Hearts.
Deep in our hearts. Let's take the light that is in this room and also the warmth of the congregation and the people of BUC forward this week as we greet new people and people that we don't know. Amen.
So we're going to close with Go Now in Peace. We will sing it two times through together, and then we will break up into four groups.
Go now.